Till 2015, Django had various hacks for asynchronous applications like chats or notifications. Then Andrew Godwin changes that by introducing Django channels, which integrates very well with Django. Then again, in Channels 2, he rewrites it to take advantage of Python 3's constructs like await and async. But many struggle with the initial tutorial for Django channels, which involves creating a chat application. This could be because a lot of concepts and abstractions are introduced in the same tutorial. So in this screencast, we'll be trying the other common application for channels or asynchronous code, which is to build a notifications app. There is not one, but three projects, starting with building an echo consumer, and then followed by building a tic-tac consumer, and finally a user creation notification. These will be built incrementally on top of each other so that the concepts will be clear to you. I am Arun Ravindran, and you're watching arunrocks.com screencast. We'll create a new folder for our project. I prefer to go step by step by creating my own subdirectory and then running Django admin start project. Instead of letting Django admin do that itself, it gives me a little more flexibility in naming the directory. I use pip env, which is an excellent dependency management tool. When I create pip env, when I create a virtual environment using pip env shell in an empty folder, it automatically creates a virtual environment not exactly under this project, but it will be created in that path which is shown above, it's home, arun, local, which is a place, common place for all virtual environments. Next, I would like to install Django. This is similar to running pip install Django. Oops, I should have used the pip env install command. Since we are installing, let's install channels as well. And another optional channels project called Channels Redis, which we will use towards the end of this screencast. I'm speeding up the video a bit here because installing and adding dependencies might take time. At the end of everything, pip env creates a pip file .log file, which gives the actual versions and the dependencies pinned by version. I have created a new project called Channels Project in the current directory, and I'm going to start a small app called Notifier. The name will be obvious when we use the last example, but currently we are just using an app called Notifier. This notifier would contain our consumers and would be used for our project for creating the views as well. Next, I'm going to create a git ignore for ignoring the .pyc and the databases which are created by this before we start an empty repository or initializing the git repository. I'm adding all the created files to Git, and I'm also committing an initial commit with all these files. As you can see, a few of the files have been ignored thanks to git ignore. We are going to call this initial, and we are going to commit this to the Git repository. Next, I'm going to create a template that should be shown as a home page. I'm creating templates subdirectory inside the notifiers directory, and I'm going to create a simple empty file called home.html. I'm going to switch to my Emacs editor now. You will be able to follow the path here I'm going inside notifier templates and going to type a very basic HTML file that should be displayed when you open the website. Later we'll update this HTML page with the WebSockets and other JavaScript, but currently it'll just contain a very basic HTML markup from the head, which just shows the title, the body, which shows just the main heading, which is notifier, and then close the HTML. Just a very basic HTML page that we want to see when we open the website. I've turned on the sidebar, which shows the location within the project, so that you can figure out easily where we are. I've opened the settings file because I have not added our notifier app. But before that, I'm going to add the debugging host location. So 0.0.0.0 is usually the local host. And I've alternately used 127.0.0.1 as well. Next, I'm going to add the notifier installed app. I'm not going to add channels yet. So I'm going to use one of Django's generic views for creating the homepage called template view. It just takes a template location or a template file name and renders that. I call this my home view. It's derived from template view, and the template is home.html. This would be pretty much our view, and we can go back to our urls.py and wire up that view to our root path. I'll be using the new Django 2.0 simplified path notation here. You would notice that the path admin is also using the same path notation rather than a regular expression. The empty quotes actually signifies the homepage, which is what you see when you immediately open the site. So home view as view would generate the generic view required for rendering our homepage. I think I missed a comma here. All right, now let's run the server. You'll notice some warnings about unapplied migrations. Our app is not using admin or the database, so you can safely ignore that. So we have a notifier page, a very basic page up and running. Next, we'll create a simple Echo WebSocket application. Let's stop our server for now. Coming back to our project, let's add channels to our installed apps, because we are going to use channels in this example. As you know, we always have a WSGI application setting. In channels, we have something called an ASGI application setting. Quite similar to the WSGI application setting, except for WSGI in the middle, we'll use dot routing dot application. As you can see, there are a lot of similarities between creating an ASGI application. I think it is deliberately trying to mimic what we have for a WSGI application that is used by Django by default. Next, we are going into our notifier and create notifier app and creating a file called consumers.py. We'll be using a consumer called async consumer. I prefer to use async consumers because they are more performant than sync consumers. They are non-blocking. If you would like to know more about how to create an async function, please refer to my previous screencast on async and await. The link would be in the description below. The first function we'd like to create is to handle the event, the connection event. So this is an event handler. It'll handle a connection event, and it'll send an accepting an event sort of a message when a WebSocket tries to connect. So WebSocket connections happen at the beginning when a client joins, tries to connect to our website or a web application. And we reply with a WebSocket.accept when we get that event. Next, we'll try to create the receive WebSocket receive event handler. This event handler also receives an event object as its argument. We'll just reply by sending the same event payload that was sent to us. So it will be an echo of the received payload. So as you notice, whenever we do any blocking function, any blocking activity, we use await. So sending something to a client over a network is a blocking activity. So that's why we are using await before we use send. This time we'll actually use a payload. The text argument will actually contain the text what was sent to us. It's a simple echo of what we have received. Next, we create a file called routing.py. This will sit right next to urls.py and have a similar function in an ASCII application. So routing is what urls.py actually performs, and routing.py will actually identify what protocol is being used for each connection and route accordingly. So that's why we need to import a protocol type router as well as a URL router. The URL router will be used within the protocol router. Next, we'll import the consumer. In this case, it is the echo consumer that we just created. This application instance is actually being referred, is the same application instance being referred to in the settings.py. We'll use a protocol type router to identify what protocol is being used. In this case, we are going to handle a WebSocket using the path which was specified for that WebSocket. That's why you're going to use the URL router within the WebSocket. So here I'm going to use WS, which is the popular shortcut or the path, which is a top level prefix, which is used for WebSocket paths. And I'm going to wire it up to our echo consumer. Next, I'm going to edit our HTML page to handle WebSockets. Whenever we use WebSockets in channels, we can import some static files which are provided by the channels apps. So that's why I'm using load static files. Within head, I'm going to import those static files, which is nothing but JavaScript file containing the definitions for the WebSockets. So this is located at this path, which is a standard path provided by channels. /channel/js/websocketbridge.js, and I need to import that so that I can use that object within my JavaScript code. So next I'm going to type some JavaScript code. If you are already familiar with JavaScript, or then it should be familiar to you, but even if you are not familiar with JavaScript, it should not be very difficult to understand what's going on here. It's pretty much boilerplate after this point, after you create the initial JavaScript code. So I'm creating script tags here, and I'm going to create an event listener for this document, which is this HTML page. And the event listener will actually wait for the page to be loaded. And then execute the rest of the JavaScript. This is similar to our jQuery wrapper, that if you are using jQuery, but here we are going to use only pure JavaScript to avoid any dependencies with any external libraries. So this function body would be invoked once the page is loaded, which is what we want because we want the entire DOM to be available and loaded. Next, we're creating a WebSocket bridge instance. So this channels.WebSocket bridge is what we imported earlier using static tag. And we are creating an instance of this object called WebSocket bridge. We initially connect to this path, which we used earlier, slash WS slash. And then we are going to listen to that location for any events. So typically this would be handled by a function which has a signature called action and stream. What we are going to do here is as soon as we receive anything, we are going to log it to our browser, a console log, using a console.log function. It's just going to say it's a response, and we are going to pass, we are going to log whatever two arguments we have received. To simplify debugging, I've created a top level property called WS, which contains a WebSocket bridge. Sometimes you don't know whether the WebSocket bridge is initialized properly, so I just add that for debugging purposes. You can later remove this once you deploy this for production. Now we have our application ready. We're going to run the server. Our server starts in a different manner. And you will notice that our notifier app page now contains some output in the console. You might need to refresh that page to see the output on the console. So as you can see, the document.ws points to the WebSocket bridge object which was created. Let's send something to this object to see if the consumer is working properly. Yes, we have received the response back. This went all the way to the Django Channels application consumer and came back. You can try some other example and it'll still work. And if you look at the network tab, you'll notice that the WebSocket was retrieved. Even if you notice our server, it's actually handling WebSockets, handshaking, and connections. You also have Django development server now switching to async server. Now let's extend this example a bit by creating a fun TikTok application. I'll explain that in a minute. Before that, let's go back to our consumers. Consumers are usually the heart of a Django Channels application. This is where we change most of the handling logic. We are going to use async.io.sleep. That's why we need to import async.io. I'm going to use a slightly higher level consumer to derive rather than async consumer this time. This would be similar to using generic views instead of a normal view. So I'm going to use channels.generic.websocket import async JSON WebSocket consumer. Yeah, that's the one. So it automatically handles JSON sending and receiving of JSON objects. Let's change our class completely. So let's delete that. I'm going to create a new consumer called the TikTok consumer, which would be derived from the async JSON WebSocket consumer. This kind of consumer does not deal with low-level details like connections and disconnections too much. All you have to do is just accept the connection and proceed. Already it would be having the logic to accept connections. In this case, we are not going to wait for any activity to be, any event to be received. While connecting itself, we are going to start an infinite loop where we sleep for 1 second and we'll send a JSON object. In this case, it'll be just a string. That's technically not a JSON object, but it works. And after another second of sleep, we'll send another JSON object called talk. And this repeats infinitely. So this infinite loop will not stop. We don't need to in this particular example. We also need to make some small modifications to ensure that instead of echo consumer, the path is routed correctly to the TikTok consumer. If we need to, let's look at our HTML as well to see if our HTML needs any changes. I think this is fairly good. We probably need to just remove the stream. Remember, the stream was null in most cases and it was being echoed or logged in our browser. So let's go back. Our server might need to be restarted in this case. So let's restart the server and go back to our browser. Again, let's refresh our browser so that the new application is loaded. You'll notice the network activity indicates that the WebSockets have been retrieved. And as you can see, the console shows a nice TikTok pattern, which shows that the asynchronous code is running perfectly. Finally, we are going to create an app which gets notifications when a new Django user is created. So let's run the migrate command because we are going to use the admin interface for the first time. Let's also create a super user because we'll need to log into that admin interface. I prefer to use the username admin. This will be our way of adding new users, and this is not necessarily the only way. Sorry, the password didn't match. The other ways of command line based, the shell based approach is also fine for adding a new user. Next, let's open a new terminal and install Redis. This is the command I use for Arch Linux. In Ubuntu and other operating systems, it might be different. Once you have installed Redis, you can run it using the Redis server command. As you notice, the port 6379 is where Redis server starts listening for connections. Let me open a new terminal and test if the Redis is working by using Redis CLI client and sending a ping command. It responds correctly with the pong command. So I know that Redis is running, which is a prerequisite for using the channels layer. So let me start by adding a setting for our channel. If you are using channels layers, you have to use this setting called channels underscore layers, which tells which backend needs to be used for storing as the channels storage backend. In this case, I'm going to use Redis. So I'll use the default backend as Redis. If you remember, when we installed pip installed or pipenv installed channels, we used channels underscore Redis as one of its dependencies. Now we are going to import one of the objects defined in that called channels underscore Redis dot core Redis channels layer, Redis channel layer. And we are going to configure the port as well. As we saw earlier, Redis host is running on the local host. In this case, for this particular example, I'm running it on my own local host. And I also have the standard port number, which is 6379, used for Redis to be listening for request. Once I've configured that in settings, I can proceed by creating the consumer. But before that, I need to create some Django signals which listens for when a user is created. This is pretty standard Django signals handling, which has signals have been there since the initial versions of Django. So I'm going to follow a pretty standard approach here. Before you actually create signals, you need to register the signal somewhere. The recommended place to do that is within your apps.py. For that, you need to go to the init.py underscore underscore init underscore underscore dot py to show that this is where your app config is located. In the Notifier app, there's already an apps.py. As you can see here, this is already created by Django when you run start app. All I need to handle is the ready when the app initializes. And this is where I import my signals. I have not created my signals yet, and that's what I'm going to do next. All right. So in the signals.py, I need to handle the creation of a user. Whenever a new user is created, it's basically a database object within the database, within the user table or the user object. So that's why I need to import the standard Django contrib.auth user model. Once I do that, I need to handle this event before the user is saved, or rather after the user is saved. So I could use pre-save or post-save. In this case, I'm using post-save because I want to handle, I just want to be notified of the creation of the user. So I'll just wait for the user to be created, everything is completed, and then I want to handle this. I import a decorator called receiver. So this receiver automatically wires me up to handle the post save event or the signal. And I'll only handle this if a user is getting created, not for any other model instance being created. I call this function as announce new user. When I use this event handler, I need to follow these argument as a part of the function signature. That's the standard argument list. If created is necessary to check to handle this only at the creation of a new user. As you know, post save will be handling any case when you are saving something. So next I want to create a channels layer. So a channels layer is like a common communication channel for all instances. So I use the get channels layer for retrieving the channel layer for the entire application, and I'm going to use it in a synchronous code. So that's why I need to convert my asynchronous code synchronous code. Remember, everything within Django is running synchronously. So I have my channels layer, and now I'm going to convert send a message to this channels layer in the form of a broadcast. So that's why I'm using this for broadcast purposes. I'm using this function called group send. Since it's an asynchronous function, that's why I'm using a wrapper around it called async to sync. Everything within Django is happening synchronously, so this asynchronous function should be invoked in a way that it is blocking. So that's what the wrapper does. The async to sync converts it into a blocking call. And the JSON object being created here is the actual payload, what I'm going to send to the group. And the first argument, gossip, is the name of the group. So I prefer to call it gossip because it's a gossip event about a new user who has just joined our web application. The type of the event is user.gossip. All the dots will be converted into underscores when they are handled by consumer, that we'll see later. So just remember that the type is user gossip, the event is new user, and the username is the name of the user who just got created. So once we have that, we have a signal which passes this message to, or broadcasts a message to, a consumer. Now the consumer needs to listen for this event. So let's first change the name of the class to Nosy Consumer. In this consumer, we are going to be fairly interactive. So we're going to respond to events. In this case, we are not going to need much inside a connect. So all we are going to do is we are going to retrieve, you know, what is the channel layer which is already passed by default for any consumer in and available under self.channel_layer. And we are going to add our channel to this broadcast group. So every channel has a unique name that is available as self.channel_name. And we are going to add our channel to that group. The next line is actually a debugging tool. I mean, we are just going to log using a print statement that we have added ourselves to the gossip channel, just to be aware that, you know, if any new client gets added, we're going to copy the connect function to the disconnect function as well. They're fairly similar in terms of structure, so I'm going to change the name to disconnect. And in this case, we don't need to accept anything. We just remove that line. We need to remove ourselves from the group, which will be the main function of the disconnect. So as soon as this WebSocket is out of scope, we need to remove ourselves from that broadcast channel so that the broadcast channels only have the active listeners of sockets who are, you know, listening to that particular channel. Next, we are going to handle the user gossip event. Like I said, user.gossip type event is now automatically translated as user_gossip event. And as soon as we receive the gossip that a new user has been added, we are going to broadcast this event to everybody else. And in this case, what happens is the event was already broadcast, so we are going to send the broadcasted event to the listener who is actually waiting for any notification in that channel. And we'll also use a print message to say that we got that message. So this is pretty much our consumer start by. Next, we move to routing. In this case, we need to handle the NoSee consumer, so we make we rename our consumer. We're going to also change our path to notifications/ instead of the standard WS, so that it's clear that, you know, it's notifications that we are listening for. Next, we look at our HTML file. This file needs a couple of changes so that we can display the notifications as well. We'll display our notifications as an unordered list, which will have a unique name, notify list. The ID will be used for query selection of the item within the DOM. Just to make it more clearer, we'll just add a paragraph which says notifications and leave it at that. Next, we are going to look at how we can handle, you know, and parse an event which is received from a WebSocket and convert that into a DOM element. So I'm going to first query our unordered list and save it as NL, which is short for notify list. Next, we are going to handle the notifications from the appropriate path. So we'll need to change that path from WS to notifications. And then our action, the event listen, the event response to listening to events happens here. So we are going to check if the event is of type new user. If a new user gets added, that's the type we look for. Next, we are going to add a element which represents an unordered list item, and we are going to populate that using backquotes or backticks, which is a new syntax, which is basically similar to our Python f strings. In the sense that if you use dollar braces within that, it gets interpolated into the value of that particular variable. So you know, this works something like a template within JavaScript. So I'm going to say that a new user named action.username in bold was created, and they have joined. And once I've created that element and populated its inner HTML, I can add it as a child of that notify list, so that as soon as a new user event is received, an element is constructed, its inner element is populated, and it's added or appended to the notification list as a new element. So we have our HTML page ready. Now let's run the server to see how our channels application is working. You'll notice that our Redis server was also running in the background. I've opened two browser windows. The top is our usual notifications application, and the bottom, I'm just logging into our Django admin interface to create a new user. I'm going to give some username and password, and this, as you would remember, is the minimum required parameters for creating a new user. If the user got created correctly, it should appear at the top. As you can see, as soon as you hit the save button, the notification that the new user has joined has appeared. And you can also see that the response shows the type of the object and whatever was sent back to the client. Just to see if it works again, let's try creating some other username called Dolphin, and try creating that user and see if the notification appears correctly. And here we hit the save button, and immediately you notice that the new user joined has come up. If you found this screencast useful, then you can learn more from my book, Django Design Patterns and Best Practices. The second edition is out and you can get a copy. Please subscribe to this channel as well, and stay tuned for more screencasts. Thank you.